also, in addition to the, to your statement, also the Crusaders and in the Spanish Inquisition, we should not forget that a great number of books were burnt. But let me also go to my Tehran expert, Mr. Talebzadeh. Do you agree with Mr. Howard Bloom?
You know, I let me add a point. I would like to say that this issue of the freedom of speech itself has to be rewritten. I think when you consider the freedom of speech and hallow it and consider it sacred, I think there's a problem there. Whoever came up with this freedom of speech, you can say anything you want with no red lines, you can burn anything you want without any boundaries and bounds, I think this is the issue that one day in the future will be reconsidered at any rate. The West has lost all thoughts or all ideas of what is sacred. It has lost it during the Renaissance. And this concept of what is sacred does exist very strongly in the Islamic world.
Can we say that the West has perhaps lost its values?
Yes, I think to a certain degree the West has lost its values. We do obviously need to respect other people's religions. And coming back to the point of burning sacred book of the Muslims, the Quran, I think that is disgusting. Really, really bad. There's absolutely no reason for that to be done. Whether it was a publicity stunt, it's just a lack of respect for somebody else's religion, and I just want to deplore that. So it does mean that the West has lost its values. Okay, we know it's down to the media who actually allowed his story to go through, but I also would say, in a way, it's good, if that could be the word to use, that we get to see these things out in the open, because I think it brings us to a point where we can actually respect people from different religions. Any sane person would know that burning a book from any religion is not going to, you know, obviously make people feel happy, but we can still build bridges from that.
Okay. Well, let me go right behind you, the gentleman with his hand up. What are your thoughts on that? Right behind you, yes, with a tie.
Yes, I'd actually like to respectfully disagree with Mr. Bloom's comments that he made earlier. I mean, there have always been limits to freedom of speech, and I know some people like to pull Voltaire out of the hat and try and use that to justify, you know, desecrating holy books or burning scripture. I don't think that's relevant at all in this case. And with regards to something that somebody mentioned earlier about Zionism, I think perhaps we might need to refocus on that again briefly, and just to look at what their role was in instigating or perhaps distracting people from certain other issues that are going on in the world today.
Well, let's focus on that. Had this, if anybody says anything about the Holocaust, there are repercussions for it in the United States. Isn't that so, Mr. Bloom?
There are people who are Holocaust deniers who are able to spread their point of view on the internet. They are able to publish books. Certainly, people like me disagree with them, but I disagree profoundly with those in the audience who have said that this is part of a Zionist plot, and who have implied that Zionists control the media and the banking world. None of that is true, and I find it as deeply offensive. As a Jew, as a Zionist, I find it as deeply offensive as the burning of the Quran.
Well, let me go to my guest in London then. Is that true what Mr. Bloom says? Do you agree with his statements?
Essentially, I disagree with his statements. It's well known, if we look at various academic literature, the impact on the Zionist lobby with regards to American politics. I mean, to even claim something antithetical to this would probably mean that Bloom is probably living on another planet. But I would like to add that this whole situation, especially with regards to freedom of speech, we must understand Western tradition and Eastern tradition. And I think they meet at some point, because Western tradition, if we read the works of John Stuart Mill, Thomas Paine, and others, they always said that if you're going to express yourself in an environment, in a public environment, it has to be pegged on the framework of morality, of moral norms. Now, these neoliberals, what they do, they're trying to clutch at intellectual straws, and they want to run away with, you know, certain statements and say, no, we should express ourselves in any way possible. But we all know freedom of expression, or expression in a particular society, is pegged on law and values. And the discussion should be what law and what values must we be following. And if you look at, for example, the duplicit behavior and the hypocrisy coming from the Obama administration and Western media, when they were saying, yeah, you know, it's not good to burn the Quran, it's insensitive, but you know what? You know what? It's still freedom of speech. This is a joke. What if the Muslims started to burn the Bible, which we believe is a haram, it's a forbidden thing to do anyway? What if Muslims started to do things like, you know, go crazy about the cartoons? We saw the fury that happened. 100 people died, embassies were burnt, and the focus was on the Muslims. And there's a duplicit behavior when it comes on the one hand, when certain people in the West are doing things in the name of freedom of speech, but when it comes to the Muslims, oh, they're so wrong, they're so bad. So what we have to do is really understand the Eastern and Western tradition and see what they meet, so we can have a positive discussion with regards to what's happening.
Just one second there. I'd like to cut you off there because I'd like to give my New York expert, Mr. Howard Bloom, to respond to you. Yes, sir, you go ahead, please.
Iranians have been burning American flags since 1979, since the Islamic Revolution. Iranians have been going into the streets chanting death to the Americans. Palestinians have been going
How does that translate into burning of Quran? That's what I don't understand. There's two governments have conflicts. How does that translate into burning of a Quran?
I know this is not your point of view, but in my point of view, it is far more damaging to burn
or
to call for the killing of a human being than to kill a book.
Okay.
When you chant death to the Americans and death to the Jews, that's calling for people's death. That's unacceptable.
That is calling for people's death. Well, let me get to this then. Following the Terry Jones's calling for a Quran burning day, there were protests in Afghanistan, which resulted into two deaths. Doesn't that translate into U.S. government taking action, which his words have actually enticed hate and resulted into death of at least two people and many more being injured? Yes, you, sir.
The expert in New York is responsible for this question. But speaking of freedom of speech, I remember the former Russian politician's sentence who said, by freedom we mean freedom from hooligans, not freedom to hooligans. So I believe that by no stretch of the imagination could we ever call it freedom of speech whatsoever.
Let me go to my next guest in London.
I'd like to make a point regarding the flag burning. It is relevant because in that Afghani protest, they were burning American flags and they were saying death to America, death to America, when in fact they didn't realize they've actually been liberated from an oppressive regime. So at the end of the day, I think it's really important to look at both sides of the picture.
Okay, well, let me go to my Tehran audience. Yes, you, ma'am, please, go ahead.
He earlier said that in the West we have got the freedom of speech to express their ideas about Holocaust. I would like to mention something which happened in August. A Dutch Muslim group published a kind of cartoon which suggested that the Holocaust was exaggerated and was made up by Jews. And that group was fined €2,500, whereas there was no punishment for people who burned Quran. I would like to see that, what your thoughts are about this issue.
Well, let's not forget that also in Europe, to add to your point, some people were also jailed and imprisoned for denying the Holocaust or minimizing its effects. Yes, you, Mr. Bloom, what are your thoughts on that?
We did not have a problem like that in the United States because we do not have laws against hate speech in the United States. We do really believe in freedom of speech. Two Qurans were burned in the United States. Terry Jones, the reverend who threatened to burn the Quran, did not burn the Quran because he was begged not to by so many people in the government and out of the government, including people like me. However, there was a Quran burning here in New York near the World Trade Center, and there was a Quran burning in Lansing, Michigan. No one is prosecuted the man who burned the Quran in New Jersey lost a job he had had for 11 years and was condemned by the governor of the state and was condemned by the senator of the state. Frankly, as somebody who has fought for freedom of expression for many, many decades, I found that disturbing. I was very disturbed that he had burned a Quran, but I was equally disturbed that he had been fired for burning a Quran. The reason that there are fines levied against people in Europe is because Europe does have laws against hate speech, and those fines are used equally. Wait, 1 minute. Those fines are used when Muslims are offended. Brigitte Bardot was fined a huge amount of money for saying things that were offensive to a Muslim group simply because she complained about the inhumane way she felt that animals are slaughtered in order to be halal.
I'd like to give time to my London expert to respond to you.
Well, essentially, what we have to realize is that Muslims are not that sensitive. We don't really have a problem with discussion, dialogue, and debate. What we have a problem is how we couch that debate and that discussion. Historically, for example, if we look into Baghdad, what we saw in Baghdad historically, we saw atheists, deists, Muslims, Christians, and lots of people from different theological and political and philosophical points of the spectrum coming together and having a frank, open discussion. The Quran, which is the book of the Muslims, tells us to debate in ways that are good and to talk with good speech. So there's an importance here, and there's an element of focusing on having good debate and dialogue. But good debate and dialogue is not actually, you know, using the media opportunistically. It's not burning the Quran. You know, this reminds us of the days in Toledo when they used to burn the Talmud for God's sake. You know, this is not civilization. This is why I like to come back on my point of freedom of speech or expression. It's actually pegged in society's values and law. For example, in Britain, we have libel laws, we have hate speech laws, and the list goes on and on and on. The point I like to make is, what are the values and what is the law expression should be pegged on? I would argue that these values and these expressions should be pegged on the Islamic view on law and the Islamic view on morality, because it's not only has shown that differences can come together on a platform and have frank discussion, but it has also shown that expression is not just for the sake of expression, it's neoliberal view. Actually, what expression does is for acquiring truth, accountability, and justice.
We're going to take a short break and take a quick look at news in brief. We will be right back with today's hot button topics, the burning of Islam's most sacred book. Stay with me, your host, Amir Rouhani.